So today we are going to speak about the ECG localization of the ventricular tachycardia. Why are we trying to talk about this? Is because this is something really important. Because you can not only localize the different types, you can also give the prognostication how good or bad or the lethality of the arrhythmia. You can also speak about, you will be knowing how easily treatable they are. You can also use the different types of specific drugs. So for example, for beta, if there's RVO outflow tract VT, you can use a different type of drug. Similarly, fascicular VT, they will respond better to a different type of drug as well. So on these basis, this is what we'll be trying to talk about. So I have already said in my previous sessions, there are different types of VT on the basis of origin. It can be LV origin, otherwise it can be right ventricular origin. So in the right ventricular origin, it's pretty simple in the sense either they originate from the outflow tract, the parahesian, tricuspid annulus, the pulmonary artery, or otherwise some other sites are also there. Okay. Similarly, LV origin, you know, there are a lot of bigger sites. So one is, of course, the outflow tract. Okay. So the outflow tract, similarly, you can divide supravalvular, infravalvular. So in the supravalvular, it can be on the basis of the different cusps. Different cusps where it can be used, the left coronary cusp, right coronary cusp, non-coronary cusp. Non-coronary cusp is mostly for the atrial tachycardias, but rarely. Otherwise, the junction between the left coronary cusp and the right coronary cusp. Okay. And the infravalvular, it can be used AMC, outer mitral continuity, or the septoparahesian area as well. Okay, and you may also encounter sometimes those GCVs, so what is called as the great cardiac vein, otherwise the ones which will be coming from the coronary sinus. In fact, I ablated one of the cases recently. I was doing some international proctorship for those cases. Anyways, now, so other than the outflow tract, the one of the important areas is the fascicular VT. Fascicular VT, as we are already aware, one is the anterior fascicular, posterior fascicle, otherwise the upper septal fascicle. And then, other than these areas, so other than the fascicular, other than the outflow tract, so what are those other VTs is? The other areas are the mitral annulus, papillary muscle, or the cox. So papillary muscle, as you are already aware, there are two of them, anterolateral, and also the posterior medial, in fact. And last but not the least, what is called as the epicardial origin of the VTs. So I have already been trying to say to you guys, like, try to focus on the basics. And why is it so? Especially those surface ECG is always the key to understand any kind of ECGs as well. So for example, whenever you're trying to look at the V1 ECG, especially in the ECG, so what happens is, it gives you literally the potential anatomical site, because the different leads starting from V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, they all are corresponding to the different anatomical sites. Okay? So what happens is, if it will be anterior RVOT, RVOT means right ventricular outflow tract. So what you will be seeing is, it will be a typical left bundle branch morphology, okay? Especially in the V1, okay? And then what is going to happen is, you may see a small variable R, which is seen in the V1 lead, in fact. Moreover, these kind of ECGs, if it is getting origin, especially from the, you know, left coronary cusp or the NCC or even the AMC as well, so you'll be able to notice in the V1 is, you'll be seeing a small but distinct R wave, okay? You'll be easily able to identify a distinct R wave, especially in the V1. So that is when, whenever you kind of see of those kind of a distinct R wave in the V1, you should start thinking about the cusps for that. Similarly, if you're thinking about the posterior mitral annulus origin, so what is going to happen is, there will be a RVB morphology. So now you know already the V1. So on the basis of V1, you can say, is it RV or RVOT or not, or similarly the cusps origin or not. Then one of the leads, other leads, which is really important, is lead 1. So what happens is, if there is a, so you are already, you can see the polarity, how the polarity is there. For example, for the lead one, so the, from the positive to the negative, okay, so the, this is the lead one, this is the lead three, and this is the lead two, okay? So the current always flows from the this direction, okay, as you can see it over here. So for example, now coming back to our basic question, how will you use lead one to find the origin? So if there is a focus which is near or above the pulmonary valve, so you will be able to see the, it, there will be typical all negative, so you will be seeing this QS complex, okay? So in the lead one, similarly, if there is an origin on the right side of the RVOT, on the right side of the RVOT, so for example, if it will be free wall, one will be positive. Do you understand? Don't forget, don't underestimate those individual leads. Those individual leads are very important. If you see one is positive, so it will be free wall. Similarly, if in lead one you see biphasic, so it can be either anterior or even posterior as well. So that is what is called as a biphasic pattern. Similarly, I hope you all can remember for the AVL and AVR. What is AVL stands for? A actually stands for augmented leads. Okay, so this is something really important to the basics. Let's not forget our basics. So what is happening is, if we will be able to see it, if we all can really recall those leads, they are really superior leads in fact. Superior leads in the sense, so if you're trying to see for the outflow tract VT, let it be the left side or the right side. So if you see a negative complex in the AVL and AVR, that is the one which will be outflow tract, because it is taking origin from the opposite side. So that is why it will be, if it is, so outflow tract, because you know, okay, one of the other concepts as well is which you all should understand is what is called is the base of the heart and the apex of the heart. Right? Apex of the heart is lower and the base of the heart is above, in fact. That is where the outflow tract VTs take an origin. So in the outflow tract VTs, what is going to happen is the QS is going to be negative in the AVL and AVR. Okay? However, if you will be seeing in the parahisbundle region is his bundle, you are already aware, right? So in that area, especially in if there's a VT which is originating from the RVOT already, we spoke about it, right? So you will be seeing is AVL becomes either isoelectric or more slightly positive. Otherwise, the AVR remains negative. So remember it like this. L is positive, R is negative. That's what I used to remember, you know, for my own purpose. Now coming to the suprapulmonary VT. Suprapulmonary VT, so you should again also try to remember is the pulmonary artery, which is there, it is on the left side of the body. So it is on the left side of the body. So that is why there is more negativity in the AVR. You understand? So how will you be doing, is it from the left side or not? So if there is greater negativity in the AVL compared to the AVR, that is what is the suprapulmonary VT, in fact. And our favorites, 2-3 AVF, we can understand it very well. So what happens is all the outflow tract arrhythmias will always have a positive reflection in the inferior leads, okay? Similarly, the ratio of the positivity, what is the R wave amplitude, will give a clue also to the origin, in fact. So similarly, what happens is suprapulmonary valve arrhythmia, what will happen is there will be a taller R wave in lead 3 than in the lead 2, in fact. So now one of the other anatomical differentiation, which we all should be able to understand, is what is the difference between the free wall versus the septal wall. So what happens is, the septal ones are always narrower, okay? There's hardly any notching or fragmentation. So if there's notching, if the QRS duration is more, then chances are high that it will be more of a free wall, right? So in this figure, you can already see that the pulmonary valve has been differentiated into the anterior free wall, posterior free wall, posterior septal, and the anterior septal. So that's how, as I said it, you should try to differentiate between the free and the septal wall. So I already said to you about the different types, okay? But if you're trying to really look out for those ECG summaries, so this is what it is, actually. So what happens is, left coronary cusp, if you will be seeing, of course, it is going to be a left bundle branch block. And if you will be seeing the axis, it is going to be inferior axis, okay? And on the V1, V2, this is how you'll be seeing this RS, RS, big R, small r, big S. And these are the signs which you're going to see. And I'm going to explain to them to all those things, especially in the coming slides. So similarly, about the papillary muscle as well, and the fascicular VT, and outflow tract VTs as well. Further, how can you differentiate? So our VOT, I had already said it, the transition normally tends to be happening around V3. So in the anterior septal, how will you be differentiating on the basis of the lead one? Is it positive? Is it negative? Like that, right? And don't forget the parahesion. So parahesion is almost similar, but what is going to happen is the AVL tends to be positive or isoelectric. And in fact, in lead one and the V5, V6, there's a taller inferior R. Okay? So, and these are the septal, the tricuspid annulus, or the pulmonary artery ventricular tachycardia types as well. I'm going to show you some examples as well. Okay, now coming to the examples. So, when we are trying to see our heart from above, this is how the heart is going to look like. The mitral valve, the tricuspid valve, and the pulmonary valve is the one which is in the front. Then after that is the aortic valve. Okay? So this is when you are trying to see it from the above. So we can already see it like this. And as I had already said it, so how will you differentiate between the pulmonary valve versus the RVOT versus the LV outflow tract? So I had already said it, what happens is the transition is happening around V3, V4. If there is free wall RVOT, transition will be slightly late. However, if it will be septal, so the free versus the septal, I already said you, on the basis of the fragmentation, the QRS width, and also the notching which is present. But other than that, also transition can also play a little bit more important role. So what will happen is the free wall RVOTs, they tend to have a slightly late transition. Similarly, the RCC, the right coronary cusp VTs, will have a later transition compared to the left coronary cusp. So as I had already said it, free wall versus the septum, okay, there will be notching, the QRS width will be bigger, in fact. Anterior and posterior similarly, in that I had already said it, if the one is negative, it is going to be more leftward. Similarly, if one is more positive, it is going to be more rightward, right? This is a wonderful slide. In the sense, in a single slide, if you be able to read it well, understand it well, you can localize any kind of VT. I am 200% confident for that. So, how will you differentiate them? So, as I said it, initially, you should try to look out for the bundle branch morphology. Okay, so what happens is you saw a left bundle branch block, and you also saw. So let's try to first of all differentiate. any of those ECGs either will be having a right bundle branch block or otherwise a left bundle branch block. But if you come across a left bundle branch block with a precordial R transition which is happening three or before, okay, if it is happening earlier, you know, than three, so it is going to be the RVOT, right? And in the RVOT, we had already said it, different types, LVOT as well. Sometimes it can happen, yes, I had already said it. However, then even some of those other areas as well, it can be there. However, if after four or after four, if it is happening, it has to be, again, chances increases for the RVOT, okay? Then again, you should try to see for the AVL, AVR ratio, otherwise, the V3 transition, what happens is, if you'll be trying to see for the ratio in the V2, I'm going to show you some more examples. I can understand it can be becoming a little bit confusing for you when you try to understand them. I would really suggest is come back, again, go through these slides, whatever has been taught to you again and again. And those are the things which will reinforce the basics in your brain that you'll be able to recall them very well. So, as I was telling you, so again, if it is in the V3, then you will have to start looking at the V2 transition ratio. I'm going to speak about it. So if the ratio is more than 6, it is left ventricular outflow tract. If it is less than 6, RV outflow tract. Similarly, if you already got all those things, right? So after that, if you are thinking how to go further, so you will have to really look at the lead one. For example, you already got it as like a RVOT by looking at these things. So after that, you should try to look in the R wave in the lead one. Is it dominant or not so dominant? If it is dominant, pretty positive. Okay, so you will be thinking about the posterior RVOT. But of course, if it is negative, you know, so then it will be anterior RVOT. So further, if you really want to, you know, differentiate, so in the, try to look in the AVL. In the, if is it big R, small s? Otherwise, there is a big R, small s, and again R dash as well. So if it is present like this, then of course it will be free wall RVOT. Okay. Otherwise, if it is not, it is going to be there in the His region, in fact. Similarly, in the left ventricular outflow tract, you already got a clue that, okay, now the ECG already showed me like this, and it looks like a LV outflow tract. So then what you should try to see is, you should try to see in the, go to the lead V6. In lead V6, if the S wave is more than 0.1 millivolt, similarly, MDI, if it is less than 0.50, if it is yes, you should always try to think for, of course, is the endocardial. It is endocardial LV origin from the mitral annulus, aorto mitral continuity, and so you will try to differentiate further. So what area is it and all? Okay. So we will be speaking again more in detail. I'll share some more tips about it. Similarly, if it is not, then what are you going to do? So you have to think about the aortic cusp or the LV summit. So from there, you will be calculating the MDI. If it is MDI is more than 0.50, you should think for the LV summit. So the LV summit can be further. You can try to see further QLR ratio, in fact. Otherwise, in the aortic cusp, you will try to see if there is S in lead one, it will be left coronary cusp. If there's R in lead one, it is right coronary cusp. Otherwise, the Q or the small Q or big R is there in the V1, it will be the junction. So the outflow tracks, okay, now we solve the mystery. So other than the outflow track, there are other regions as well, which I already said it to you. It could be, you know, the annulus, annular VT as well. It could be the mitral annulus, even the papillary muscular VT as well. So I'm going to show you some more examples. Okay. So I already said to you, what do you notice in the, for example, the RVOT, free wall, and the septal wall. So what do you notice over here is, what do you notice? So if you will be looking at the V1 to V4, so what I had already said it is, in the lead one, if it is, the transition is already there, which I already said, which is very characteristic of the RVOT origin. So other than that, if you look, the lead there is one is positive, of course it is going to be the more in the posterior wall of the RVOT, right? So similarly about the cusps as well, if you'll be having a confusion for the different cusps, how will you be trying to see in this? So for example, that's why in this figure we have given all the examples of the left coronary cusp, right coronary cusp, the junction, then the outer mitral continuity, the great cardiac vein, and the RVOT septal, in fact. So what do you notice actually over here? So what do you notice is, if there is a QS complex, especially in the lead one, sometimes you will be coming across, and there is a characteristic pattern break from the lead V1 to V3 with relative negativity in V2, and there is also delayed pattern of the initial QRS complex. So for example, what do you see in this ECG? So what are you going to think for? So this is what is characteristic of the epicardial ventricular tachycardia. So epicardial ventricular tachycardia, you should also try to see for what is called as Marshalinsky's criteria. Marshalinsky criteria is, so there are different parameters for that. What is called as pseudo delta waves. Anyone is aware of the Marshalinsky criteria? So Marshalinsky criteria, what it says is 34, 85, 121. So what happens is 34 milliseconds is the width of the pseudo delta, 85 milliseconds in the QRS till the nadir of the S wave, from the start to the nadir of the S wave. If it is more than 85, similarly, if the QRS width as well is more than 121, or broader the QRS, it is going to be favoring the epicardial VT. So now in this ECG, what do we see? So it looks like an outflow tract origin. So outflow tract, as I had already said, it is towards the outflow, where the blood vessels are, major blood vessels are coming out, and they are just going out for the circulation, in fact. Right, so I had already showed you this relationship, right, the how the V1 to V6 they are related to each other, especially in relation to the heart. So what happens is, always remember, if the transition, what is happening is, if the transition is happening around the, So what had happened is V1 to V6, as I had said it, after V3, if the transition is happening, right ventricular outflow tract, no doubt about it, okay? And yes, if there is a right mental branch block, you have to think for the mitral annulus, in fact. So as I already said it to you, this is how the orientation of the leads. So if the transition is happening in V1 or V2, up to V2, LVOT. And I had already said it, V3, after V3, it will be RVOT only. So now when you are trying to look at from the above, so what do you see? So even in the RVOT, as I had already said, how will you differentiate between the free wall and the septum wall? So what is happening is, you should try to look for the positivity in the lead one. Right, if one is positive, it will be becoming posterior wall. So these are the different areas I had already explained, free wall versus the septum. So free wall, what do you notice? They are more broad, notched. Notching is also there, right? So similarly, this is another case. So in this, now we'll be knowing about the free wall versus the septal and all. But a lot of times confusion comes is about, as I was already telling you, what about the LVOT origin? So about the LVOT origin, what is going to happen is you will be seeing the R to QRS ratio in V1 and V2. Okay? So there will be R and the QRS. If the ratio is more than 0.5, it will be pointing towards LVOT origin. Otherwise, if R to S ratio is more than 0.3, it will be LVOT. So, V3 transition, a lot of times we tend to think that, yes, that is the key, which I had already said it. But over here, when we are trying to look at the transition, what do you think? So sometimes it can be pretty tricky, right? So that is why. So there are some newer formulas which has been said. So newer formulas about the V2 transition ratio. So in that, they say it like this. About the ratio. So ratio in the sense, if the PVC is after the SR, then it is 100% RVOT. So how do you see about it? So for example, initially you will try to see in the lead tree, the V3, is the RS transition is happening or not. Okay? And if the transition is happening after SR, yes, if it is happening, then RVOT. Otherwise, you will have to see in the V2 transition ratio. Transition ratio is the ratio of the R to the, as I had already said, this is the formula which is already given over here. But yes, it can also have some problems in the sense you should not apply it for the bundle branch block patients. So I had already said it to you. What happens is there are different types of LV outflow tract localization as well. There are different areas. How will you localize over there? How are you going to localize? Does anyone recall? What did I say? How are you going to localize? No? Okay, no, so but I already said it is once you're already having is LVOT. So in the LVOT, what are the different types? I had said it is non-coronary cusp, right coronary cusp, the aortic mitral continuity, otherwise the different areas. So what are the things on the basis of what will you be able to differentiate? So how will you differentiate? So what had happened is, as I had said it, you will try to look in the lead V1. Okay, so the transitions are always important. So the transitions, how are they important is, as I had already said it, is whenever you come across an ECG like this, you should go for, start looking at the transition, especially from the lead V1 to the V3. So how is the transition happening, and where is the transition happening? So these are the ones which will be, okay, I will not try to get you guys confused, okay? I can understand. It's not always the easiest, in fact, okay? So how will you be able to see for that? So, okay, I'll try to give you some more diagrams as well, which will be helpful to make you understand what are the different areas where those problems can be happening, in fact. So what will happen is, I hope you can already notice the different coronary cusps in this view, and this is the summit. So for example, what is going to happen is, when you are trying to see from the below to above, this is how it looks like. So these cusps are very close to each other, and of course close to the mitral annulus. So similarly, even you try to see at the level of the LV ostium as well. So these are the different cusps, and anterior mitral valve is pretty close, and then comes the posterior mitral valve, and this is how is the orientation. So the front is the anterior, the back is the posterior, and this is the left side, right side. Okay, so this is how it goes on. So this is a beautiful CT image trying to show you the relationship of the left atrium, aorta, and the RV outflow tract, and the outer mitral continuity for the different areas on the basis of ECG. Okay, this is really a nice diagram. So one of the other important things I would like to really emphasize to all of you is, whenever you're trying to localize, always ask for the lead placement. How was it kept in the clinic? Or how is it being kept in front of you, or otherwise in the lab, wherever you are doing there as well? And a lot of times, even if you're trying to do a stress testing as well, you have to be really careful for that. Because on the basis of that, you can change the polarity of those leads, which can really cause a lot of problems as well. When you're trying to localize further, okay? And yes, it can change with the age as well. And what is the other problem? What tends to happen is, there's also unfolding of aortic roots, especially with the age. So that's why you have to be slightly careful. So can anyone make a guess? Where are we going to actually? So we are going to the great cardiac vein through the coronary sinus. So we are pretty deep inside over there. So we are trying to get some potentials. We got good potentials over here, and it was really ablatable. So these are the different areas. So I have already given the names to make it easier for you. So in the aorto mitral continuity, in the right coronary cusp, on the right and left junction. This is already a big hint in the sense, so whenever you try to look at the ECG, also try to look at the V2 ratio and the lead 2 as well. So this will be able to help to differentiate what about those possible origins. So this is again the origin for the different cusps area, left coronary cusp, right to left summit, the right coronary cusp, or the left coronary cusp as well. So can anyone make a guess? So what are the what are the catheters, or otherwise how many things are there in this patient's x-ray? Can anyone recall? So I'll tell you already. So there's an implantable loop recorder. This is a quadripolar. There's a retrograde axis RF catheter. And the patient has already undergone also a Okay, not this patient, so it was a different one. So this is another patient as well with such kind of ECG. So we tried to do a 3D mapping and we got some good signal at the PVC1 area. So this was different patient. So this patient, yes. So what are the other things which do you notice? Where are we? This patient has already undergone a CRTD. There are those leads available, you know, sheaths and all, everything you can see. There's an LV lead as well, on catheters and all. So we went to the cuspal area. So it was very close to the RVOT and we could ablate it well. So now coming to the parahesian origin. So what happens is, if you see in lead one, if you see a big R or small, or big R but small s, or big Q and small r in the V1 with a transition which is pretty early, and the ratio of R in 2 to R in 3 is more than 1. Okay, so that is the one which will tend to specify towards the parahesian origin. So this is what you see. An important thing to differentiate for us is between the fascicular and the papillary muscle VT. So the papillary muscle VT, don't forget, there is no Q in one or AVL, okay, which is mostly present in the fascicular VT. So Q waves may be present in the fascicular, but not in the papillary muscle VT. And yes, papillary muscle VTs are mostly broad. So how do you differentiate between the anterior fascicle and the posterior fascicle on the basis of the early lead 1 and V1 morphology, in fact? So sometimes some of the origins can be also from the moderator band, in fact. Yeah. So I hope you guys were able to understand today. Are there any questions so far?